Final item of business today is members' business debate on motion 23220 in the name of Ruth Maguire on 70th anniversary of Human Rights Day, and this debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Would those members who wish to speak in the debate please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Ruth Maguire to open the debate for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I begin by saying how grateful I am for the cross-party support from our Parliament in acknowledging the 70th anniversary of Human Rights Day and allowing this debate to go ahead. 10th December 2020 marks 70 years since the UN invited states to celebrate an International Human Rights Day, marking the adoption of the Universal Declaration on Human Rights in 1948. Human Rights Day is an international reminder of the critically important progress that still needs to be made to protect and realise human rights to their fullest extent, and one where we can look to states to continue increasing progress in human rights. With that in mind, I want to take the opportunity this evening to echo concerns raised over the UK Tory government's intention to review the Human Rights Act. We must be alive to the threat to human rights protections in Scotland and indeed of weakening citizens' rights right across the UK post-Brexit. It's absolutely crucial that clarity is received about the scope and impact on devolved matters and Scotland's separate legal jurisdiction of this review. My understanding is that there's been no consultation with the Scottish Government, and I wonder if, in summing up, perhaps the Minister could speak to that and update Chamber on what action the Scottish Government intends to take in that regard. As a country committed to standing up for human rights, the European Convention on Human Rights is hardwired into the Scotland Act. Any plans from the UK government to bypass the devolved governments or water down protections must be robustly challenged. The COVID-19 pandemic has highlighted states' approaches for human rights globally, with governments being required to balance the need for restrictions to save lives with the potential impact on the human rights of their citizens. This year, as we live through the pandemic, we've seen deep-seated existing inequalities that have stubbornly persisted for decades highlighted and in many cases exacerbated. The harms caused by the pandemic and those resulting from the measures that have been put in place to manage it and save lives have not been felt equally, and our government's responses should continue to reflect that. And the decisions that are made, the importance of ensuring fairness and quality of life for all our citizens, must not only be considered but acted on. Amongst it all, though, we've also seen wonderful work executed speedily with the needs of our people right at the centre. For years, campaigners had called for dignified food provision, accessible information, online classes and support with loneliness and isolation. And in a matter of weeks this year, those things became really quite mainstream. And more than that, we got to a place where no one had to sleep rough on the streets. Endeavours to respect, protect and fulfil human rights, of course, go beyond the immediate response to COVID-19. And at the same time as the Tory government seem intent on weakening citizens' rights post-Brexit, the SNP Scottish government is instead working to strengthen them. As the current passage of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, UNCRC, shows, this important bill has received widespread support across a range of stakeholders, perhaps most importantly by children and young people themselves. And I think it really demonstrates our government's commitment to human rights. It demonstrates their commitment to fully realising children's rights. I'd like to end by also acknowledging the work of the National Task Force for Human Rights Leadership established by the First Minister, which is working to establish a new statutory framework for human rights that can bring internationally recognised human rights into domestic law and protect the human rights of every member of Scottish society. Scotland has an important role to play in promoting international dialogue and respect for fundamental human rights. And I want to thank every single human rights defender in our country who helps to do just that. And I would ask us all to use Human Rights Day to reaffirm our commitment to lead by example and ensure that the rights of the people of Scotland are respected, protected and fulfilled. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. McGuire, and our apologies that we didn't set the clock at the beginning of your contribution. You didn't really speak as fast as you thought you might have. And we'll move on to the open debate, please. I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Bill Kidd. Excuse me, Mr. Balfour, but you're mute. If you just give us a little second or so to see if we can fix that.
There's a sound malfunction.
Oh, terribly sorry, we have a sound malfunction. In other words, we can't hear him. No, I think perhaps what we'll do is we'll go on to Bill Kidd then and try and get Mr. Balfour sorted out. Bill Kidd.
Yes, thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, I'd like to start by thanking Ruth McGuire for creating this opportunity to formally recognise the anniversary of this important and historic event, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. I know Ruth has constantly and continually used her role in the Scottish Parliament to promote the furthering of human rights, so I appreciate this opportunity being brought to the forefront of the Scottish Parliament today. This Thursday will mark 70 years since the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and 70 years may seem like a long time, and the ideas underpinning human rights may seem quite obvious now, but we must remember that it grew out of the most tumultuous period in human history. The impression of the weightiness and security of the idea of human rights is evidence of the conceptual success of the Declaration. Appeals to human rights are embedded across societies, and citizens now expect that appealing to human rights as a way of explaining an injustice is an effective way in which they can make positive change happen. And personally, I've seen this work effectively in the field of nuclear disarmament, and one of the reasons that this is so effective is because human rights are built from a true conception of morality and ethics. The truth underpinning human rights is that people are born with inherent value, and that there is nothing that can add or be stripped from this inherent value. If you are born of certain wealth, status, ethnicity, gender, or with a disability, none of these things make someone more or less valuable, and this doesn't ever change. That is the fundamental ethic of human rights, and it is fully true. Human rights afford freedom of thought and belief. It is the opposite of control, repression, or subjugation. It is the lifting up of the subjugated and a calling of accountability to those people or states that would curb these fundamental freedoms and personhood. Human rights were born in the aftermath of the Holocaust, in the fall of empire, in the nationalisation of states, and the formation of the United Nations. They saw a collective effort of people across the world to promote the plight of the marginalised or those without a voice. Human rights recognise personhood and provide room for our concept of personal liberty. Human rights underpin the values that are important across the banner of Scottish politics, all of our Scottish politics. Whilst the concept of human rights may be prolific in our society, they are not yet accepted globally. And that is why we have to fight to protect human rights and shore up the integrity of the thought system behind rights. Freedom of thought, speech, and personal liberty are paramount in the system of thought that sees individuals valued, no matter their creed. In Scotland, we are a place of refuge to many who have fled repression or come to live in security without fear of conflict and war, and the consequent persecution of their families due to ethnicity or faith. I'm proud to live in such a country and to represent some of its people. And we must continue to fight for human rights both in and out with Scotland. And this means addressing continued inequalities, the main one of which is poverty. In practice, this means reducing child poverty and fuel poverty in the attainment gap and building good quality homes that are genuinely affordable. It also means protecting free intellectual thought, discussion and debate. This is because this fundamental principle is the cornerstone that upholds all of our human rights. Thank you very much indeed.
I think we'll try again to have Mr. Balfour, and Mr. Balfour will be followed by Mary Fee. Oh dear, Mr. Balfour, I'm sorry. We're still not hearing you, so I'm going to go to Mary Fee and we'll keep persevering. Mary Fee, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I too begin by thanking Ruth Maguire for securing this very important debate tonight. And Human Rights Day is a time for both celebration and reflection. And during my time in Parliament, I have championed human rights, and they have always been at the centre of everything that I do. And that is because when we put human rights at the foundation of our decision making, we all reap the rewards of a more equal society. And although we celebrate Human Rights Day, we must remember that for billions of people, human rights are not a given. They must be advocated and campaigned for every single day. These rights are not handed to us. We are only afforded them when we fight for them. And on this 70th Human Rights Day, there is one group of people who now more than ever need us to fight for them and their access to human rights. Transgender people across the world, including here in Scotland, face unprecedented levels of discrimination. And Presiding Officer, the fear and the hatred that trans people contend with every day just to live as themselves is unacceptable. A right to life, to privacy, to freedom of thought, conscience and religion. There are some people who do not believe that these human rights should be extended to trans people. And that is a very dangerous thought, and it is one that we must confront. And this poisonous bigotry has to stop. Health is a human right, and trans health rights are being attacked daily across the globe. This is an attack on their human right to health and to life, and we must condemn it. In Scotland, healthcare for trans people requires significantly more resources and more support. The most recent figures show that waiting times to access a gender identity clinic in some areas of the country were on average 260 days for adults and 314 days for young people. This is far too long to wait for an initial appointment. Services need to be more localised, and we need more staff to provide support for those who are working under extremely strained circumstances. And Presiding Officer, in preparing for our post-COVID-19 world, we must put human rights first. Today was a historic day when the first vaccines were administered in Scotland. And this shows that when we work together to find a solution, to put an end to huge scales of pain and suffering across the globe, we can do anything. There is, however, much more work to be done as we face a jobs crisis, climate crisis, and a mental health crisis. Human rights must be at the core of the solutions to these problems. We should always be aiming for the next 70 years. When someone who may not even be born today stands up in this chamber to celebrate the 140th Human Rights Day, I hope that they can look back and remark on how the world pulled together and brought us back from the brink. And I hope that they live in a world where human rights and equalities lead the way in every single thing that we do. And to conclude, Presiding Officer, Thursday is Human Rights Day, but we need to approach every single day as though it is a Human Rights Day. Thank you.
Go now to John Finney.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And can I too thank Ruth Maguire for bringing this important debate to the Chamber? And daily we see how important rights are and how they must be protected. As a member of the Justice Committee, we are scrutinising two pieces of legislation at the moment where rights are very important. Defamation, where the right to freedom of expression, which we know isn't an absolute right, comes up against the right to protect your reputation. Similarly, the Hate Crime Bill, where the right to utter expressions of antipathy, dislike, ridicule and insult comes up against the right not to be a victim of hate crime. The term chilling effect has come up in our scrutiny a lot, and in each of these pieces of legislation, if we fail to get the balance of these competing interests right, then someone's rights will suffer and or nothing will change. And I believe that an unwillingness to address an issue, perhaps wrongly fearing change might tread on rights, but because it's too controversial or complicated, and similarly have that chilling effect. Presiding Officer, there's no wee boy in Vietnam whose ambition in life is to work cultivating cannabis in a bungalow in the north of Scotland, all the while being told by his controllers, who literally hold his life in their hands, that he's in debt to them for taking him to London, where he truly believes he is. Likewise, no wee girl in West Africa sets out with the goal of having her body treated as a commodity to be used and abused by men in Scotland. She's not an entrepreneur, she's not exercising her free will, she's a victim. And let's be very clear, the victim of men in Scotland who pay for her services. And what a vile euphemism that is. Men who provide the market for human traffickers, men who make the human traffickers their sordid fortune. Now, I recognise that issues like abortion and medically assisted suicide, both of which engender strong views, are legitimately viewed as an individual choosing what to do with their body. If that's a decision taken by someone of sound mind, fully aware of the issues and in control of themselves, then it's none of my business. However, the same cannot be said in relation to sexual exploitation, the owner of the body being unable to exercise choice or display free will. They are trapped, and it should be everyone's business to end such suffering. Now, I wrestle to reconcile arguments about the so-called sex industry and the simply graphic facts of human trafficking. The exponential increase, the term used by Peace Scotland last week, 84 women forced into prostitution when 9 of the victims reported were under 18, the youngest a 13-year-old child. I abhor what one victim described as the trade in trauma. I want to understand how we better address the issue. Is there a hierarchy of rights in Scotland? Do Scotsmen's perceived purchasing rights trump those of a trafficked girl from Sierra Leone or Stirling? So whose rights are we going to prioritise? Am I a man who condemns gender-based violence, who recognises the gender power imbalance which fuels so many societal problems, to try and find a rights-based justification for the men in Scotland whose actions fuel this globalised crime industry of human trafficking, the men who abuse women and girls, the so-called customers? Presiding Officer, I've found as I've got older, my right to change my mind is very important. In recent times, I've witnessed firsthand the inability of medicine to control pain. That changed my mind on the issue of medically assisted suicide. When I'm increasingly confronted with the sexual exploitation of trafficked souls, I must rethink everyday language like the term, the sex industry. Men have no right to buy another human and use and abuse them for their sexual gratification. And Scotland's laws must change to reflect that. Any meaningful human rights impact assessment of this tragic situation will evidence that's the right thing to do. Thank you.
Now call Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today we celebrate the 70th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And I want to thank Ruth Maguire for leading this debate tonight and for, I think, the wonderful work that she does as Chair of the Human Rights and Equalities Committee. And I know that's something she's very committed to. Because the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, a cornerstone document of the United Nations, The Declaration affirms unequivocally that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity, with dignity and rights. The Declaration is inextricably tied to development, setting out the rights of all to a standard of living adequate for health, well-being, including the right to education, the right to work, and the right to social security. I too would like to put on record my thanks to Alan Miller, Scotland's first ever Human Rights Commissioner, for the work that he's been doing leading the National Task Force for Leadership and establishing a new statutory framework for human rights in Scottish domestic law. Some very good speeches tonight. Mary Fee talks passionately about the rights of trans people, and John Finney, a wonderful speech about the scandal of human trafficking and gender-based violence. And Bill Kidd, as always, passionate about the rights of asylum seekers. I do agree with Bill Kidd that Scotland should be a refuge for people fleeing conflict and their violations of basic human rights. There are many other articles of the Convention, the right to marriage and family, the right to own property, the freedom of belief and religion, and the freedom of opinions and information. There are many others. Some communities have disproportionately been affected during this pandemic, and I want to highlight some of those groups. Initial analysis of the direct impact of the coronavirus by ethnicity and disability has shown greater impacts for some ethnicities. There has been a very poor level of information available about the impact of COVID-19 on ethnic minorities in Scotland. Because of this, full picture of the impact on people from Black, Asian and minority ethnic communities is still not available. We must protect our BME communities and their health by applying human rights to the situation we face now. And despite that less than 1% of the population living in care homes, deaths from coronavirus in Scotland, care homes have made up 2/5 of the national total. I raised the scandal of the Do Not Resuscitate orders earlier in this Parliament and their use during this pandemic. I don't believe we got to the bottom of this, but I do want a declaration that there never will be, and any future Scottish Government will ever allow such a policy ever to be enacted ever again. Age Scotland has called for a parliamentary inquiry into the handling of Do Not Resuscitate notices, and I look forward to the outcome on that. Whilst the presiding officer, I wanted to talk about the group of young adults who've been shielding throughout this pandemic, who've been especially badly hit. The age group of those between 18 and 24, in particular, a group who've had to give up their freedoms and their jobs in order to protect themselves, their own health, but obviously to help protect the country from transmitting the virus. They've experienced reduced social contact with their peers, and that's a particular group that really do need addressing in relation to the mental health services. Human rights must be applied to them in a meaningful way. In conclusion, presiding officer, for the Universal Declaration of Human Rights to mean anything in our lives, we must make sure that we try to apply the articles, the values of the articles that we believe in, and make sure in the daily work of this Scottish Parliament, in our daily work as politicians, we try to apply them as best we can. Thank you very much.
Now, we're going to try to hear from Mr. Balfour again.
It's not working, presiding officer.
Unfortunately, we can't hear from Mr. Balfour. We have had some technical problems. Can I just say for the record that Jeremy Balfour tried very, very hard to contribute to this member's debate tonight, and we're sorry that we're unable to hear from him. And I'll therefore move on to Christina McKelvey to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Okay, thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to conclude today's debate by thanking all of the members who are marking and celebrating the 70th anniversary of Human Rights Day on the 10th of December by demonstrating Scotland's strong and unwavering commitment to protect, respect and fulfil human rights. As we've heard from, I think, all members during the debate, 2020 also marks 70 years of the European Convention of Human Rights, which was opened for signature on the 4th of November 1950 and signed by the UK on the same day. This convention brought a new commitment and awareness of human rights and fundamental freedoms. And as Bill Kidd said, this came from one of the most tumultuous times in modern history, a place we never wanted to go back to. In the week that marks this anniversary, the UK Government launches yet another review of the Human Rights Act. The safeguards provided by the Human Rights Act protect every member of society and ensure that public institutions uphold our most fundamental rights. This means we all have freedom of expression and the right to a fair trial, have privacy, and can all challenge decisions that affect us. These rights are central to the law of Scotland. They are at the heart of the devolution settlement, and they demonstrate our commitment to protecting human rights internationally and for people everywhere. As others have indicated, the COVID-19 crisis has brought all of this into sharp focus in a very unprecedented way. The clear necessity for human rights to be at the forefront of all of our policy making and to be embedded throughout it, we have made clear on our continued commitment to do that during the COVID-19 response and beyond. The Human Rights Act is critical to achieve that, and that is why the Scottish Government vehemently opposes any attempt to undermine or weaken the Human Rights Act, given the UK Government's review report on, and I quote, balance between the rights of individuals, our vital national security, and effective government. My fear is that this is exactly what the UK Government is trying to do and has been threatening to do for some time. Ruth Maguire is correct that there has been no consultation with the Scottish Government on this, but we do believe we have a Scottish representative on the panel, and we will continue to push to ensure that we have full and continued involvement in that process. She can be in no doubt of that, and I'm happy to restate that. So rather than launching yet another attempt to rewrite the Human Rights Act, the UK Government should really focus its efforts on making rights real for everyone in UK society. We need to champion international standards, not retreat into Brexit isolation. The Scottish Government will continue to champion and progress human rights leadership wherever we can by enhancing those rights and freedoms that we all enjoy. We want to go forwards, not backwards, so on human rights, and we want to do this with the people of Scotland in an open way that fully aligns with a human rights approach. Current legislation in the Scottish Parliament will bring the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child into Scots law. Our national task force, which will report next year, is actively developing proposals to extend human rights law even further. It is essential that the review group consults fully with Scottish interests, not just the Scottish Government, but this Parliament, the wider public sector, civil society, and yes, the general public. This must not become another exercise that undermines devolved powers or the constitutional settlement. And Mary Fee reminded us very powerfully how fragile our rights are, and its message that we must all hear and take action on. Mary Fee is absolutely right. The National Task Force for Human Rights Leadership, which is taking forward proposals for new human rights legislation in Scotland, is working collaboratively and openly across our society with a wide range of people representing the broadest range of rights, including disabled people, older people, people from minority ethnic communities and LGBTI+ backgrounds. This extensive engagement and outreach work, which has been taking place over the recent months, will be essential in informing and shaping this legislation. And can I also reassure Mary Fee and John Finney that any hate crime is completely unacceptable and not tolerable to the Scottish Government. It will not be tolerated, whether it's your race, your religion, your disability, your sex, your sexual orientation, or indeed your transgender status. It is already clear that there is a strong breadth of support from the task force work. That there is also wide recognition that the impact of COVID-19 pandemic, while felt by all of us, has had a particular impact on people who may already face challenges in realising their human rights. As the task force work progresses, we will work hard to ensure that we bring everyone with us on this journey to implement a strengthened and ambitious framework for human rights in Scotland. Presiding Officer, we aspire to be a world leader in human rights, and we demonstrate leadership and share practical experience of a human rights approach to policy making and delivery. as part of our continued commitment to the internationally renowned human rights defender fellowship. We have doubled the grant this year for that programme, supporting human rights defenders both nationally and internationally is one important way that we can hold duty bearers, including this Scottish Government, to account. John Finney gave us a very powerful testimony in why being a global leader in supporting international human rights defenders is incredibly important, and I agree with him on that point. As part of our commitment to human rights, we want to ensure children are treated fairly and equitably and respected as equal citizens. By introducing the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child and Corporation of Scotland Bill to the Scottish Parliament, we have taken the first important steps to making that a reality. The bill will fully and directly incorporate the UNCRC into Scots law to maximise to the maximum extent possible within the Scottish Parliament's powers. Alongside this, the programme for government outlined our intention to incorporate the UN Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, something I'm sure the Chamber will welcome during these 16 days. Bill Kidd talked about personhood and the lifting up of those rights, and I'm sure he will be pleased to hear that we will also actively consider the incorporation of the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities and the International Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. We're working very closely with stakeholders in these sectors and on the task force. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, today we celebrate all of the important improvements we have made to the lives of people in Scotland and Europe since 1950. There have been the obvious monumental advances that have come to mind, for example, the Equality Act, when we think of human rights, but we also have huge strides. We've also made huge strides this year, and we still have huge strides to make. The coronavirus pandemic has further demonstrated to us the importance of embedding a human rights approach. It has affected different groups of people in different ways and has a particular impact on some groups, but our sustained commitment to human rights has ensured that we continue to protect all of our society for everyone in Scotland. Presiding Officer, these strides in development are significant, and Scotland will do whatever it can to continue to be a leader in these human rights. And I thank very much the convener of the Equality Human Rights Committee and my colleague Ruth Maguire for bringing this debate to the Chamber today. Thank you.
That concludes the debate, and this meeting is closed.